Good morning or afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Director's Cut. I am Brad Keelor, the director of the Geo-Institute, which is why we call it Director's Cut. On this show, which we release once every week, I interview GI members about hard-hitting issues about their lives. Might be something about work, but it also might not be. You might find out, as you have in the past, what their favorite soup is, what their favorite pizza is, what their sporting experiences have been, or a wide variety of other things. This week, we have a very special Halloween show. And so, as you can see, we are in costume. If you have just tuned in, wonder no longer. I am a Rubik's Cube. My guest, Alan Cadden, is...
the Mad Hatter. Or Corona hair, whichever one you want.
And so we will have several questions with Alan here in a moment. Alan, as you may know, is a past president, board member of the Geo Institute. He is a current board member of the Deep Foundations Institute. Most of his time he spends at Schnabel Engineering as a principal, and he will give us his exact title in just a moment. Happy Halloween to everybody, and Alan, thank you for doing this.
Brad, good talking to you again.
We are going to start, if you are ready, with a 45-second description of your job. Who are you every day?
Wait a minute, you told me no tough questions.
I just started off right away. They're going to get a lot harder than this, so strap yourself in.
Hey, okay, we'll see if I can do my life history in 45 seconds. I grew up moving around quite a bit. My dad was in the restaurant business, so he got transferred several times in my youth. But I ended up in Richmond for most of my school years, from probably about sixth grade on. In high school, I actually attended an experimental school called Richmond Community High School, which was a different experience and a very small group of students there. Then I got to spend six glorious years at Virginia Tech. So that was a fun experience. I'm now living outside of Westchester, Pennsylvania with my wife, Kathleen, and four children. Not very small children any longer. Two of them are still in college. The other two graduated and now starting their careers. I've been with Schnabel throughout all my professional career, really. It's been 35 plus years. And I've held many positions, starting with a couple co-op gigs back after my junior year at Tech. And then I recently held the position of chairman of the board for a couple of years as we went through a transition. Currently, I'm helping to lead the geostructural group and the infrastructure monitoring services group. And it's been a wild ride. I've filled a lot of roles in the company, and they've been very gracious at supporting my career development as well as all of my efforts in professional societies. So it's been rewarding for the last 35 years.
Well said. I mentioned a moment ago that you were a past GI president. I believe the year was 2014, 2015. What were your favorite and least favorite things about being GI president?
Wow, time flies, man. That was a while ago, wasn't it? I think some of the best parts was all the traveling. I had a great time going to meetings and events and spending a lot of time with colleagues and learning about the kind of the breadth of the profession. There's a lot of interesting stuff going on out there. I have to say I was particularly happy to have been a part of the organization when we really saw kind of an explosion of student participation. That's been real satisfying. The challenge probably was trying to hold down a second job for that many years. That was a long gig. We went through a lot of interesting discussions and committees. We had a lot of discussions about conferences, bylaws, committee structure overall, funding changes. It was a very busy 7 years or 6 years. But on the bright side, when you spend that long working with the GI, you get to see all those great students start their career and get well established before you finish out your rotation.
And they're probably all getting close to 30 now, and they're watching this, and they're looking back and saying that felt like a really long time ago. Something completely different. I know that you and your family had the opportunity to be on a home improvement show, for lack of a better term. What was your reality TV experience like with the DIY network? Tell us all the good dirt. Well, first tell us what show it was, where people can watch it, and then tell us some inside dirt.
Well, it was a DIY. It was called Stonehouse Revival. Jeff Devlin was the host. He's still floating around out there, and I think he might be trying to start another show at this point. I believe you can get it off Amazon Prime, season 2, episode 5 or something like that. It was really fun. It was an interesting experience. You know, when you nod and smile at your wife too long and she fills out the applications, and next thing you know, you have people tearing up your house. I mean, that's the way it goes. The only criteria is we weren't allowed to peek. So Kathleen and I honestly did not peek. They put up tarps and closed off that side of the house. The kids peeked. They were over there checking it out pretty regularly, but we didn't look. The real downside of a show like that now is Kathleen realizes that major projects like that can get done very quickly. They had 15 days to kind of gut 3 rooms and completely rebuild them, and they did that. I think that was an endorsement for liquidated damages, because my understanding was that if they missed a shoot day, there were huge costs to the contractor. So they were here working long nights and weekends and got it all done. But it was a lot of fun. I ended up missing an ADSE meeting during the premiere and had quite a few friends sitting in a bar texting me as they were going through the premiere and mocking me. So, but it was fun.
That is great. I want you to think back even further now. We've talked a little bit about this in the past. I want you to impart the lessons that you learned from your first job to our viewers today, even if it's only one thing.
Wow. Okay. You know, I think I'd have to go back, a lot of little jobs and everything, but I worked for my dad in a deli. He had a deli all through high school and college, really, in Richmond. And it was an interesting experience. You learn a lot about people. I learned a lot of basic life skills, you know, cooking and cleaning kind of things that tend to help you out in the long run. But you really do learn a lot about communicating with a variety of different personalities, both the people you're working with as well as the clientele. So those were pretty good lessons. The other part that kind of led to a full service waiter job, or, you know, full service restaurant job, in which part I did, you know, cook some, dishwasher, but I did a lot of waiting tables. And the best lesson about that was in college, when you're waiting tables and you kind of have a nice conversation with one table and talk about the fact that you're in school and everything, the table next to it hears about it and they want to know about your school, and the next one hears about it. The best part is the tips go up when they hear, ask all those questions. So
the sympathy vote, you might call it.
Yeah. College students, they need the money. So tips went up. It was great.
I think one thing that people don't always think about, when you work at a small business in high school, you end up with a lot more responsibilities than you probably would have had if you were just working at the mall somewhere. I mean, I had the same experience, not for my parents, but it was really good for, I feel like, for me too. What was your least...
When you're working with your father too, there's not a lot of forgiveness there. So I quit wanting to get back to work.
What was your least favorite meat to handle? Gotta ask that.
You know, I don't know that there was anything weird. I mean, we had lots of cheesesteaks and cold cuts and pizzas, so there's nothing weird there. It's pretty easy.
No garlic knockwurst or anything?
No, just good roast beef and pastrami. I really appreciate pastrami now.
So another retro question. I didn't mean for so many of these to be thinking back. Who, when you first got into geotech, who intimidated you the most that you've met since then and can't figure out why you were so intimidated by them?
Oh, wow. You know, there are a couple people that intimidated me. My first job as a co-op was with Schnabel, and Jim Schnabel was still around at that time. And that guy was pretty in the early years. You know, he just kind of walked around the office real stiff, and He was kind of a scary dude. I learned over the years, and especially after his second retirement party, and he was still hanging around the office, usually in shorts on the way to the golf course, but we got to be pretty good friends. He was nowhere near as stoic as he was in the early years, so he was a good guy to hang out with in the latter years there. And then Mike Duncan was another one that was like that. When I was in college, I would go to Dr. Duncan's office and ask a question, and he'd answer it and help you out, and then he'd stare at you, waiting for you to ask the next question. And he never volunteered to just give you answers and everything, which I guess was a good thing because you came better prepared the next time and you thought through everything. So he helped me be a better engineer, but that was kind of intimidating the first couple of times you went in to talk to him.
Those are great answers. So then we go from way back to way recent, because you could even think about last night on this one. One of my favorite nights of the week is Sunday night. It's always very chill. I don't get worried about work on Monday morning. Maybe other people do. I don't know. What is your ideal Sunday night?
You know, and we did it last night. We were in the Amish pub. Oh, you're waiting for another. Yeah, was that one word answer?
If you got a story, that would be great. But if that's it, and that's where you go every Sunday night.
Yeah, no. The Amish pub is my version of. We have a big old bank barn. It's about 120 years old or so. And since we don't have a big farm and have use for it all, we turned the upstairs part of it in one quadrant of it into a big movie theater, basically. So there's a 15-foot screen and a projector in there, and we go in and watch football games on, you know, Sunday, Monday night football, and, you know, friends drop by, and we just have our own little pub there. It's kind of a nice, relaxing atmosphere.
That's
except
fantastic.
Our Eagles games. Then it gets a little loud.
They might turn it around yet. They could win the division with four wins this year.
Are we ahead now?
I think so. So, again, Well, this isn't really a retro question. What's everything that you've learned over the years and all the time you've spent at Schnabel? This can be for people you work with or for any young engineers out in the world. What's your go-to piece of advice for new hires at Schnabel? How do they make their way? And I guess think about, like I said, how that can apply to anybody trying to make it in the engineering world.
Get engaged. I think it's something you have to learn early. You know, it's all about your career. You have to kind of make your own way. Get your hands dirty, see projects get built, volunteer. Don't wait for somebody to hand you the next project or the next opportunity on a silver platter. You know, if you have a good idea, share it, bring it to the forefront, you know, volunteer to help with things. But don't expect to have the keys to the office handed to you in the first couple of years. You know, it just seems like so many folks sometimes just feel like they should be project managers 1 year out of school, and you know, they want to run the place 2 years out of school. And you know, there's a lot of value in building experience and you know, learning as much as you can in those early years. You know, you won't get a chance to spend as much time in the field seeing projects get built as you will those first couple of years. So take advantage of it, and that's about it. Get engaged.
Including in your professional society. We'll get that in a minute.
Absolutely, in the professional society. You know, I used to say there's kind of a 15-year rule there. The first 5 years, you're kind of the wallflower and you're trying to figure out what's going on in the local professional societies. And the next 5 years, you're very engaged in committees and everything. And third 5 years, everybody knows you and you're running the place. So, you know, it takes a while to go through that progression, so start early and take advantage of it.
So we'll get more on Alan from that in a minute. Right now, another fun one. What is your favorite dessert?
Oh, okay. You know, I think Kathleen would probably tell you it's ice cream, because there's usually ice cream in the freezer here with four kids. But I think it's key lime pie. I like the meringue. I like that limey flavor. I think that's my favorite. That's my go-to if I had a choice.
That's pretty much always a winner. And sometimes you could have key lime pie with ice cream. And
no.
That's a good call, too. You think that's over the top?
No. Well, it's one or the other. You know, it's one or the other.
What about key lime pie ice cream?
No. No. I'm a purist. Come on.
So now, Another one where you have to think back. How did you first get involved in ASCE and GI?
Like I said, it's got to go way back. You know, in school, I was part of the student chapter. I think the thing that probably got me most active was the concrete canoe. That was a really good time. There are a lot of stories there in that, but we won't go into. But
I mean, you're going to have good stories if you're building a boat out of concrete.
Out of concrete, yeah, exactly. So that was a lot of fun. And then when I went to Virginia, I was working out of a Richmond office originally. I was asked to help out with the local section there. So I did that for a little bit. And then I got transferred or moved up to Pennsylvania pretty soon after. And so I went ahead and got involved in the Philadelphia section and met a couple people. And next thing I know, there's three or four of us starting the restarting the younger member group in Philadelphia. So that would help get that off the ground. And then somehow I got involved in starting the Geo-Institute chapter here in the Philadelphia area, the Delaware Valley GI. And then it just kept growing. But, you know, as I said, you showed up for the first couple meetings and stand along the wall trying to wonder who everybody is. Next thing you know, somebody's going to pull you in. So it worked
out. And the Delaware Valley chapter remains our biggest chapter. So if anybody is watching this from the area, northern Delaware, South Jersey, Southeast PA, and you're not involved with DVGI, it's time.
It's awesome. Do it.
Final question. Well, before the special bonus question, which I'm tipping you off on here. How many times in a year do you golf?
I'm going to plead the fifth on that because my boss might see this interview and I don't want to. Anyway. Hey, I will say another great thing about professional societies, though, is there's usually a golf outing to support associated with many of the meetings. So when I was on the ADSC board, we called it the ADSC Tour. And I was going to make a suggestion. I think all of you organizations should get together and we could have the Geo Tour and we could all follow the meetings around and play golf.
Well, there are four in the core group, so we'd have the majors.
Yeah, absolutely. There you go. That's a good point.
It would be really good. I'm not sophisticated enough to come up with some chase event, though, like the PGA or NASCAR. I can't manage the points and everything. So your bonus question, after you very artfully dodged that one, is, you know, if Halloween's coming up on Saturday. For a lot of people, it's going to be a really different experience, I think, than they've ever had on Halloween before. That might be bad or good. What is your favorite Halloween memory?
Yeah, I don't know that I have a really significant Halloween memory. You know, when I was trying to think about it, I just picture coming back in. I had three siblings myself, so the four of us would go out Halloween trick-or-treating and everything. We'd come back, and I can't remember whether it's with one of those plastic pumpkins jammed full of candy or maybe it was at the point where you had the pillowcase full of candy. But you'd come back and you'd dump it all in the middle of the living room floor and start sorting through it, and you started negotiating with your brothers and sisters which candies you kept and which ones they took. No.
Did you ration yours out, or did you just go all in and eat 18 Snicker bars in a night?
No, I think I'm more of the rationer. I'm a hoarder, so I want it to last forever.
And finally, for the people, do you know more of the Fresh Prince theme song or the Eagles fight song?
You know, I think if it were many years ago, I would probably say the Fresh Prince, but I can't think of any of those words anymore. So, the Amish barn, we sing the fight song pretty regularly. So I'd have to remember that one.
Can you give us a shout out there at the end? Spell it out.
No, this is embarrassing enough. Come on.
Okay. I'll let you off the hook with that one. Alan, you survived.
A little later in the afternoon.
You survived. You answered all the questions. You made it through this episode of Director's Cut. You're prepared for Halloween, which also counts for something. Thanks to all our viewers for checking us out there. If you would like to watch another spooky Halloween GI production this Friday, October 30th, at 2 p.m., Mark Seal from Langan will be talking with Geostrata editor Mary Nodine about a project that Langan worked on with the National Park Service on Alcatraz and many other spooky stories. So you will want to check that out on YouTube Live. If you're watching this and you enjoyed it, we have a new episode of Director's Cut every single week. You can go back and watch the previous ones. We'll have new ones every Wednesday. And again, thanks for sticking around. Alan, thanks for doing this.
Brad, it's good seeing you again.
Having a good sense of humor. Yeah. This was excellent. Thanks again for being here, and have a great week, everybody. Thanks. They call the